Isambard Kingdom Brunel. He was a man of many disciplines, and he helped shape Victorian Britain.
Engineer, architect, shipbuilder, designer, inventor, and even occasionally a politician. A true polymath, his genius spanned many disciplines. He's arguably one of our greatest ever Britons. In fact, in a BBC Millennium poll, he was voted our second greatest Briton ever, besting Shakespeare and Darwin, among others, pipped only to the number one post by Winston Churchill. I'm going to follow in his footsteps and discover for myself what an extraordinary legacy he left to us all.
But what impacts, what imprints has he left on the modern world today?
To answer that question, I'm going to travel to where it all started, the Brunel Museum in Rotherhithe, southeast London. I'm going to speak to Robert Hulse, the museum director.
He saw himself as a man with profile, a man with status. In those days, engineer was rock and roll star.
Brunel's tunnel is the oldest tunnel in the oldest underground system in the world. And if you talk to people about Brunel's legacy, they'll often talk about his steamships and his bridges and his railways. But actually, in my opinion, of course I would say that, in my opinion, it's this tunnel. Because without this tunnel, you can't have mass urban transport. This is the birth of the tube system, not just for London, but for everywhere. You take a metro journey anywhere in the world, from New York to Beijing, in a very real sense, your journey began here. And you can list your favourite capital cities, you know, New York, Beijing, Berlin, London, Paris. None of them work if you don't have a fast, efficient method of moving people into the city, moving people around the city, and moving people out of the city. So Brunel's legacy, for me, Brunel's most important legacy is the one that's often forgotten, which is the world city. The Thames Tunnel was Isambard Kingdom Brunel's first project, but it was almost his last. There was a terrible flood in this tunnel in January 1828, and 6 men died in the underground chamber. One man was carried to the surface by a freak torrent of water, rescued from the top of the shaft, revived, and sent more dead than alive to Bristol to convalesce.
So Bristol is where I'm headed. Brunel pioneered the railway. Not only was it the fastest, most advanced form of transport of his age, but it also heralded an even greater change, a change in time.
So here I am, the Royal Observatory, Greenwich, where all time is measured from.
At the beginning of Queen Victoria's reign, it didn't matter much if Norwich was 10 minutes ahead of Southampton or Carlisle half an hour ahead of Penzance. But in November 1840, railway time was introduced. A standardised time was adopted across Britain, all following what is now known as Greenwich Mean Time. This monumental change was all due to the need for railway timetables, in which everyone would have to keep common time, aided by the sheer speed of this railway.
So that was one of only many actions that Brunel did that changed the world itself.
This station is a fantastic example of his meticulous attention to detail. His ability to mould harsh, raw materials into something not only beautiful, but also perfectly practical and functional. This is one end of the Great Western Railway Line, the building of which revolutionised Victorian Britain and ultimately the world. You could get on a train here in London, and 4 hours later
arrive here in Bristol, at Temple Mead Station, another station designed to the exact specifications of Brunel.
This is Brunel's city. His work, his skill is knitted into the very fabric of the city. His sheer imagination is everywhere. It's a city immensely proud of its adopted son. Many of its landmarks are landmarks thanks to the greatest engineer who's ever lived.
One thing we can't miss during our time in Bristol is right behind me, the Clifton Suspension Bridge.
For many, this bridge is the iconic Brunel structure, but sadly he never lived to see its completion, although the people of Bristol and those passing through can still marvel at its spectacle. Today I'm going to speak to Mike Rowland to understand the impact this extraordinary, bold and breathtaking piece of engineering had on the city and subsequently the world.
What separates this bridge from every other bridge in the Victorian era?
Well, for a start, it's made of iron, and it is a suspension bridge, which is quite the cutting edge of technology for its time. Most bridges at that time were stone, big archways, but you look at the huge chasm that it has to cross, it couldn't be.
Yeah.
So Brunel had this massive idea of bringing, using the new technology of iron in suspension bridges. It wasn't pioneered by him. Telford at Menai in Conway in North Wales, and even Sam Brown up in Northumbria.
Why do you think Brunel got so much credit for making a bridge like this and what?
Well, he didn't actually make it. It was his original design, but work was halted because of the financial and political difficulty of the time, and all we had were two stumps to below where you see the chains now. Well, he didn't hang about while they were messing about with all this, so he went on to become the great engineer of his day, but because he died at the age of 53, the Institution of Civil Engineers resolved to complete the bridge after his death as his monument, and they significantly amended the design. Brunel's design was two chains, as you can see there are three on each side. Brunel's design was 7 metres wide, they widened it to 9.45, effectively the width of the two footways, and they didn't bother with the Egyptian stuff like the sphinxes and all the hieroglyphs and the cladding, because they would have been expensive for no engineering purpose.
When this ship was designed and built, it was the greatest ship in the world. Other than its steam power, these propellers and its iron hull made it special. But what else made it unique? To find out, I need to go up to the surface. A lot of people like compare a boat like this to Concorde.
I would say so. Basically, Concorde changed the world. This ship changed the world. She was the fastest way you could travel from one continent to another. You could travel in comfort, in style, again, very similar to Concorde. And also the prices are very similar.
Right, yeah. Did he have any sort of shipbuilding experience before?
Brunel had shipbuilding experience. This is his second ship. His first ship was the Great Western. That, again, was the world's biggest ship when it was launched. But he had a very capable team. Brunel was one of those engineers who knew how to gather the right people around him, people who were real experts in their own fields. And he was always having his eyes wide open in case a new invention came along, an example of which was the propeller. Before he knew about the propeller and the Archimedes, he wanted to have paddles on the ship. I'm fascinated by the Victorian age and the people who were on board the ship, whether they were crew members or whether they were passengers. This ship carried the first All England cricket team to tour Australia. Without the ship, Australians wouldn't have the cricket game that we know them to have today. Anthony Trollope, the novelist, wrote a book, Lady Anna, on board. The fact that Prince Albert launched the ship in 1843, and also that 15,000 people emigrated to Australia. Today, some 500,000 people are descendants of our original passengers. I think it's just extraordinary.
flamboyance, style, exuberance, courage.
He carried people with him.
Determination.
He was bold, he was adventurous, and when people said he couldn't do something, he jolly well tried to do it, and not only proved them wrong with great aplomb.
He just had this vision of achieving what appeared to be the impossible.
Whatever he did was quite extraordinary. Yes, he made mistakes, but he learned from those mistakes.
Well, his personal motto is en avant, let's go. And the idea was, yes, he was a can-do man. He just got it done.
The story of his engineering projects are stories not of prizes easily won, but of prizes taken by you know, brute force and determination.
He was a visionary.
Great powers of persuasion, a lobbyist. Sheer enthusiasm and sheer go. Get up and go and do it.
I think he was an extraordinary engineer and a bit of a showman.
Brunel was never a man given to complacency. He pushed and extended the limits of human ingenuity. The world around us bears the imprints he's left behind. He lives on in the iconic structures and the transport of our age. His bridges, railways, tunnels and ships are testament to his grand dreams, and they ensure he will never be forgotten. It seems that over 150 years since his passing, we still find ourselves living in Brunel's Britain.